Okay, so we have an update on the Matek F411 Wing flight controller, which is mounted right in there, and the AR wing, as you see here. This is a Sonic model AR wing, pretty much stock setup, other than the changes we're going to talk about now. It's still the stock servos, stock motor and prop. The stock speed controller is nested right back in there, and that's pretty much it. Other than the FEV stuff and the Matek board that we'll talk about now. Let's start at the front. Cameras, we have the Runcam 3 mounted right in there, little holder. Still love the Runcam 3, and that reminds me, I did see kind of a hint that Runcam posted on Facebook. They didn't deliberately come out and say it, but I think they kind of might have hinted around that the Runcam 3 might be coming back. And if that's the case, I would be very happy to see that, because I love this camera and I hate how it worked out that they had to stop selling it, and I would love to see this back on the market. So keep an eye on that. Like I said, there's no promises. There was just kind of a subtle hint. I might be totally off base on that, so don't take that as fact. Just go check out Runcam's Facebook page and see their last post that mentioned Runcam 3. But moving on, the flight camera, we have the Runcam Eagle Pro 2, which is really nice camera. I used it for a couple of reasons. One, because it's a full-size camera and the cutout in the AR wing is perfectly sized for it. You can see it's just sitting right down in there. It's not glued in place or anything. It just slips down kind of a tight, snug fit into the phone. So it's perfect match for the little wing. Basically, any full-size standard shape camera like this will fit, though. But another reason I chose this one, because of the onboard audio. So I do like flying with audio, and I just run my audio straight back to my transmitter. I didn't have to use an external mic or anything like that. And the audio in these Runcam cameras, the onboard audio from all the ones that I've tried, is actually pretty high quality as far as FPV microphones go. So when I have the opportunity to use it, I like to take advantage of it. So moving back to batteries, we have two 1500 Nanotech 3S. This is the same ones I fly my Nano Talon on one of these batteries. I decided to go ahead and pair them up and run two in here. And now I do have some 3000 3S, you know, single 3000 packs, but there's not really a lot of room the way you kind of have this kind of square cavity right here. So using the two 1500 worked out good. It's kind of a more efficient use of the space available. We'll talk about the batteries more in a minute, though. You see I do have two batteries, and on the Matek board, on the power input, I soldered two battery leads to it. There's two separate leads coming straight off of the Matek board rather than using a Y adapter. I just found it easier to use one extra XT60 like that. And if I ever decide to fly it on one battery, I'll just plug one in. They're soldered to the same pads, just split at the board. Nothing special. Obviously, we have the Matek board. This is the F411 wing, and I got my two servos running over to here. This is S-bus from my Dragon Link receiver, and this is GPS cable over here. Then you have your camera connected over here, your video transmitter here, and the audio just runs straight from the camera to the video transmitter harness. For powering my video transmitter, well, let's not get too far ahead. Powering the camera, I'm using the onboard 5 volts from the Matek flight controller. I'm using its 5 volt supply, one of the 5 volt supply. You do have two separate supplies, and well, there I think there's two plus another one that powers the board. But anyway, I have the onboard supply that's already, you know, mapped out to these pins here, powers the camera with 5 volts, and then by default, the video transmitter gets the direct LiPo voltage. But I'm using a 400 milliwatt ready-made RC video transmitter. It's a 1280 1258 transmitter, and it runs on 12 volts, which is normally fine for 3S, but being directly powered off of the battery like that with no filter, you do get a lot of motor noise. I actually hooked it up first to see, and there was a lot of motor noise. It was terrible, not going to be flyable. So I had two options. I could either put an LC filter between the board and the power and the transmitter and filter the power going into the transmitter, which I've done in the past, running directly off a 3S with an LT filter with these transmitters, and they work fine like that within the normal range of a 3S LiPo. But I chose to use this power supply right here. This is a CPIC type buck and boost converter from Banggood. And basically it takes an input, I forget what the input range is right now, but you use this little potentiometer here. You see there's a little brass screw on it to adjust that little pot, and that sets your fixed output voltage. And once you have it fixed, I have it fixed at 12 volts right now, obviously, but once you fix that output voltage, then as your input voltage changes, it can go above or below that output voltage. It doesn't matter. It's always going to hold that consistent 12 volts or whatever you set it at. And it also gives you very clean power. I've ran these transmitters directly off of these power supplies in the past, and as well as cameras, and they give you good clean FPV power and video. So I mean, I like them. They're not the smallest and lightest in the world. As you can see, it's almost as big as the whole flight controller, but they're cheap and they get the job done. They're reliable. I've never had any issues with them, so I decided to put one of those to power the transmitter, and that's the power here coming, the output off of the board going into the transmitter harness. And what I did, the power input runs back to the spare ESC pads. You'd have two outputs for powering electronic speed controllers for your two motors on the Matek board. They're basically just outputs from your current sensor on the Matek board, but I use one, my speed controller is soldered to one, and the other set of pads, I just soldered the input to that voltage regulator. So I have the little BN880, I think it is, GPS. It's a U-Blox chipset GPS. It uses GLONASS. It's the 8N, I believe. It's hard to see it, but there's a little plastic piece that I 3D printed that kind of matches the contour of the fuselage, because it's obviously rounded and it's wider at the front than it is the back. It's narrower. So I kind of drew a little piece in CAD and printed that just to give me a little flat perch to stick the GPS down on. Just very basic, but if you want it, it's on Thingiverse. I'll put a link below the video. Like I said, the stock speed controller is laying right back here in the back under the GPS, and it's soldered directly to the Matek board. The power leads and the signal leads run to motor one. Well, the signal and ground. Positive wire is not connected to anything. Obviously, I'm not using the BEC and the speed controller, because once again, the Matek board does have a 5-volt supply for your servos. It's selectable 5 volts or 6 volt. There's a solder bridge you can jump to get 6 volt, but I have it set on 5 volts. My DragonLink receiver is under the tape right over here. You can see my UHF receiver just out of the view there. It's a V3 mini receiver sitting right down in here in the phone. And I have my S-bus cable running out into the S-bus input on the Matek board. And that brings up one point. There's no analog or SSI input on the 411. There is one on the 405, but it's not there on the 411. There may be a pin on one of the chips, but the processor is so small on here, I doubt you would be able to solder to it if you could find it where it's at. If it's even there, I'm not 100% positive, so don't quote me on that. It may not even be possible, but not ruling out the possibility. You may be able to find it somewhere on the board and break it out yourself, but by default, there's no way to run analog or SSI input. So what I'm doing is, with the DragonLink receiver, I can configure each channel within the S-bus stream to send various things out, or each, you know, normal channels, obviously. Or what I'm doing is I'm putting RSSI onto channel 12, because I do have 12 channel S-bus ran into the Matek board. So just at the end of the stream on channel 12, I configured it within the DragonLink receiver setup using the DragonLink configuration tool. I put the RSSI value on channel 12, and then in iNav on the receiver tab, you set your RSSI channel to channel 12, so it knows to read channel 12. And then it was off a little bit. I think it was reading between, if I want to say, like it was either 20 or 30% on the low end, and it only went up to about 85 or 90% on the high end. So I did have to adjust the scaling, the RSSI scaling in INAV configuration in the CLI. But once I did that, it reads RSSI values fine. I guess that's pretty much it as far as the basic setup. So I guess we'll get on into some flight footage now. Now what I did, I took off and I did some different configurations. I had to trim the board for level flight. I had to do a servo auto tune. Then I did, a servo auto trim. Then I did an auto tune to tune the PIFF controller in iNav. So I'm just kind of gonna run through. Gonna show you some launches and landings, stuff like that. Gonna skip over all the boring tuning flights. There was, well, I call it flights. I did all the parts, but the 3,000 milliamp hours in total. I would basically take off, get a few things done, land, save my settings, adjust things, whatever. Take off, land, like that. And at the end of the video, after that, we'll just kind of skip through that. It's gonna be real quick. But at the end, we'll have my last flight where I tested the return to home and failsafe modes, because I do have it set up, or just one of my flight modes that's just return to home, just manual, normal, nav RTH. And then I also have failsafe, and I'm not 100% sure why, but in the iNav documentation, they recommend not just using your normal nav RTH in a failsafe condition, that the receiver needs to know that it's an actual failsafe to use the failsafe condition or flight mode. So I do have that set up. I have my normal failsafe on a switch, and then I have my actual receiver failsafe set to kick the board over to failsafe mode. And something to do with controlling throttle or handling a condition where you might lose GPS, something like that. I haven't read it. Like I said, there's a lot to take in when you're getting into iNav. And this is literally my first venture into it, the first time I've flown it. So what you're going to see in this video here. There's still a lot that I don't know, so I'm not going to pretend to be an expert. I'm just going off of what I read. So if you have any questions about iNav, just put them below the video. I'll try to answer them if I know the answers. If I don't, maybe I can help you find the answers. Maybe we'll learn something together. But anyway, we'll get on to the flight footage now. One last thing before we do. I want to mention that this transmitter, this was an old transmitter in my box of spares. I don't remember the history. I have a handful of these in both 400 and 800 milliwatt. This one is 400. I thought it was a good transmitter. It seems to work fine. But I did notice that during setup on the workbench, the transmitter, you see I have a heatsink on it here, just to help keep it cool. But I noticed that it was running pretty much ice cold. It didn't even warm up when I was setting things up, when I had it running for 10-15 minutes at a time on the workbench. It never warmed up, which is unusual. These usually run pretty hot, relatively hot, when there's no airflow on it, especially without a heatsink and sitting down in the foam like this. But I did add a heatsink on this one, but it should have still got rather warm, but it didn't. And then when I got it in the air, I noticed I had very limited range, so I'm guessing it's not outputting the power it should be. There's probably something wrong with it. I do have one in another wing, in my old pop wing. I have one just like this one. I'm probably going to swap those out, or if not, I have a 300 milliwatt Racewood transmitter that's pretty similar in size. Should fit in this cutout here. So I'll probably swap it out with one of those soon. Well, I definitely will before I fly it again, but I'm going to swap it out, and that should fix my issue. But if you notice, I'm staying relatively close to home in, you know, all my flight testing, and you'll see the video dropping out even close to home, stuff like that. That's why, because there's an issue with this transmitter that I need to swap it out. So enough talking about the plane. Let's get on to some flight footage now. And like I said, we're gonna skip over all the boring tuning stuff and end with a little bit of playing around before I land it. And enjoy that, and I'll see you again at the end of the video.
Okay, so this is the last flight of the day. You can see we're going to launch in manual mode. Then in just a minute, you'll see our switch. It switches to air mode. And this is basically acro. I have air mode enabled, so it displays air mode. Just holds the last angle that you put the airplane in. No leveling or anything like that, just using standard gyro stabilization. And then I'll switch to, you see there, altitude hole, AH, is basically angle mode plus altitude hole. And what we're gonna do, we're gonna fly out a little bit, and then I'm gonna switch over to RTH to return to home flight mode. And just make sure that it does turn to home, which you can see we're doing now. And it immediately starts climbing because I currently have it set for 400 feet. But like I said, once you and put it at this pitch angle, you see I start losing video because of the issue that I mentioned earlier with the video transmitter. So I stopped the return to home mode there, satisfied that it was going to return home. And you'll see in just a bit, I'm going to fly back out and then do return to home mode next. Or failsafe mode, actually. So you see we've lost a little bit of altitude here, and now I'm going to fly back away from home, and I'm going to switch into the actual failsafe mode, which is somewhat different than return to home. Apparently the board handles things different. I'm not 100% sure on the difference. You'll have to read up on that if you don't know, or maybe you already do. You can tell me in the comments below. But like I said, I still have a lot to learn with iNav. I'm just getting started, but so far I'm liking what I see. I think I went ahead and lost a little bit more altitude and pointed the airplane back towards home. And shouldn't be much longer, I think. You'll see I switched over to failsafe mode. And there we go. See, we're all the way in failsafe mode. And once again, the airplane starts climbing for 500 feet and heading home. So I was pretty happy, pretty satisfied that was going to work. So you see there, once you come out of failsafe mode, you do have to move the stick to disable it. But everything seems to work fine. You know, as far as I've tested it so far, I will be able to do some more testing once I get the transmitter issue sorted out so I get to fly a little bit further without worrying about losing video. But anyway, like I said, we'll get on to just some fun flying now. Just like I said, I had rebooted the board a number of times during all this tuning and configuration changes and stuff like that, which resets my milliamp hour counter. So I had no idea how much I'd used, so I was just kind of relying on the voltage. So I didn't want to push it too far, so I went ahead and just flew around a little bit before I landed. But as you can see here, we're flying in air mode again. Well, acro mode with air mode enabled. But I guess we can talk a little bit about the OSD layout. I did configure it in iNav to sort of match what I use with the vector. Just kind of put things where I'm accustomed to looking for them. Now you do see in the bottom right corner I have my pitch and roll values. Those are in degrees. I have those on screen just from when I was auto-tuning, well, leveling the board anyway. Calibrating the board offsets so that the what the board thinks is level is actually flying level. Other than that, everything is my basic stuff that I like to use on the OSD. You see in the bottom left corner, that's my satellite count. I'm currently using 17 satellites, which I guess is pretty standard for the 8N GPS chipset using GLONASS satellites, but that's all my old GPS don't use GLONASS. Even my vectors, I have the version 1 GPS, the old first release GPS on both of them, and I never see that many satellites with those, so I'm really happy with the GPS unit. For the price, it works great, and it does have a compass, but I'm not using the compass. As you see, I just had four wires running from the GPS. I'm only using the GPS, not the compass. Everything else is pretty basic, should be self-explanatory. One thing I do want to do is, you see that I have the crosshair enabled for the artificial horizon in the dead center of the screen there. I may turn that off because you'll see toward the end of this video, I kind of flew down the middle of the horse pen, the pasture in the back, and flew under the trees. And when I did, you can see it, that crosshair kind of gets in my way. And I kind of flew a little bit closer than I would like to one of the tree limbs under the pine tree. Because I didn't see it because the crosshair was in the way, so I may remove that. I may take that out. There's another option for a different style. I may try that one. Or I may just remove it altogether. I like to have the crosshair just to kind of have something to align with the horizon. But it's not that big a deal. But anyway, like I said, I'm real happy with the way it flies. And yeah, I think that was that low pass through the trees coming up here. And you can see what I'm talking about now. The crosshair kind of blocks your view when you're coming lining up with the past hair, and there's that limb I passed a little close to it. But other than that, I really like the OSD. I changed to the Vision font and obviously move things around to the layout that I wanted. And I will probably set up some different layouts. You have, I think, there's either three or four. I think there's one default layout and three alternates, or maybe it's only three altogether. But anyway, you can set up multiple screens, layouts, and switch between them with a switch. So I will probably do that. But for now, this has been my experience with the Matek F411 Wing flight controller. I like it. And like I said, the only real complaint I have, well, not really complaint, but the only issue that you should probably be aware of is the fact that there's no analog or SSI pin, so that's going to limit your option for receivers if you need RSSI. Alright, so I guess that's going to be the end of the video. So far, like I said, I don't want to pretend to be an expert with iNav, because I'm not. I'm just getting into it myself. But, you know, this is not so much a review of iNav. If you're familiar with iNav and you're looking for some hardware, I highly recommend this one. If it meets your needs, make sure you have a way to run RSSI in with, you know, through the PPM or SBUS stream if you need RSSI. Personally, I don't like to fly without it. Once you have it, you don't like to lose it. It'd be perfectly fine for flying around close range, medium range. But if you want RSSI, just be aware there's no analog or SSI input pin. If you run a 12 volt transmitter, you're going to need either a filter and run 3S or a voltage regulator like I've done here. I would have been fine with an LC filter, but I'm not 100% sure this is going to stay on 3S. I may run it on 4S. If I do, everything, it'll just drop right in. I don't have to change anything. I can plug in, I think, anything up to 6S is the max on the 411. I'm not 100% sure, but whatever the voltage range on the Matek 411 is, everything else in the board can handle it. So, well, maybe not speed controller. I think speed controller is only rated up to 4S, the stock one. But it wouldn't be hard to swap it out. But I would never run more than 4S on this anyway. But anyway, we're rambling on long enough. Video is over. Thank you for watching it. Stay tuned. We're going to have some more flight footage from this in the future. Once I get this swapped out and finish trying out different flight modes, get everything set up. But I'm already impressed with iNav. Highly recommend the board. It works well. The altitude's very accurate on it, the barometer. This GPS works well. I don't know what else to say. There is no complaints. So thank you for watching the video. I hope that helps. And see you in the next ones.